Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Peace be to everyone here. I'm here another day at Speaker's Corner, another Sunday. We're here today with a lovely Danish lady. Her name is?
Pernilla.
Pernilla. So Pernilla, if you could just say hi to our viewers.
Hi.
So Pernilla, I've just seen her. Stop. She's from Denmark. You're here on holiday, are you?
Yeah, just a visit.
Yeah. So just a little bit about your background, if okay, just to contextualize this.
No, I don't know what to say.
So in terms of like belief or creed?
Yeah, from a Christian background, I don't have any, like I go to church on holidays, but I don't.
Okay.
I don't really practice Christianity.
Yeah. And one of our brothers pulled you over, and he pulled me over and said that interestingly enough, your beliefs are very similar to us, more so than the Christians. So I just wanted to know a little bit about what you do believe in essence.
Yeah. I do believe there's a God, one God,
yeah.
Not so much Jesus. I don't know. I'm not convinced of Jesus yet,
yeah.
Anyways. I believe in a God, and I believe that there's one God for all people. I don't label myself with religions. I believe there's one God, and you should follow some rules and treat other people with respect, no matter what the religion is. I just believe there's a God, and the God loves all of us, and yeah, you need to follow some guidelines to be respected by God.
Absolutely. And I'll be honest with you, if I asked a Muslim lady instead of yourself the same question, I would have received the same answer.
Yeah.
Can you imagine that?
Yeah, I can imagine that. Yeah. There's a lot of similarities to... Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, if I was to ask you,
Pernilla.
If I was to ask you, Pernilla, about your understanding of Islam, what could you tell me that you know about Islam?
I don't know much. We have.
And it's not a trick question. I just want to know, just for understanding purposes.
No, I don't know a little. I know about Muhammad, and Muhammad is and I know about Allah, but not. I don't know the Quran.
Okay.
I know passages of the Quran taught from school, but that's it.
Right. What I would like to do, if it's okay with you, is just to talk to you a little bit about Islam. And you know, if it becomes too much for you, you can always tell me to stop and shut up, or you know, just ask me if you have any questions and we can go over a few things. So firstly, I just wanted to talk to you about who Muhammad, peace be upon him, is for us, in comparison to who Jesus, peace be upon him, was for us, and the prophets before. So I mean, of course, as a coming from a Christian background, I'm sure that you've heard of the names like Moses, Abraham, David, Noah, Adam, all of these, Solomon, Jesus. And they all came with one universal message. And we believe that the message that they came with is, as you said, there's no deity worthy of worship but God alone.
Yeah.
Almighty God alone. And we call him as Muslims, Allah.
Yeah.
Even people who are not Muslim, they use the word Allah. It's an Arabic word. The one who is worthy of worship, Allah. And then similarly, these prophets, they all came down with certain miracles from God. Do you believe in the miracles that these prophets came down with? For example, Solomon, Prophet Solomon, he was given the ability, and it's also in biblical scripture as well, that he was able to communicate with animals. He communicated with spirits, and they listened to him. They listened and obeyed him under God. Prophets like Abraham, he was thrown by the persecuting disbelievers into a fire. And he said a few words on his tongue, which was, and in Arabic it's Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil, or an English translation of this is, Allah is sufficient for us, and he's the best disposal of our affairs. And from this, Allah took that fire and he made it cool. He ordered the fire that he created to be cool. And this is one of the miracles that Abraham came with, and Jews and Christians, they testify to that as well. I mean, it's part of scripture. Then you got prophets like Jesus, and Jesus, he came with many miracles. For example, he was able to cure the sick, you know? He brought life and stuff like this, yeah? Now, we as Muslims accept this as well from Jesus, peace be upon him too. But we say it's by the will of Allah and not by the will of himself. In Matthew 7:21 to Matthew 7:24, part of the biblical scripture, Jesus is told that on the day when he comes down, when he comes back, the people will say, Lord, Lord, was it not in your name that did we not prophesy in your name and cast out evil spirits in your name and in your name perform many miracles? And Jesus will turn to them and say, and this is in the Bible, he will turn to them and say plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Because Jesus himself, just like all of the prophets before, he worships one God. As you said, you worship one God, you know? He testified that there's only one God, and that is the God above everything in heaven. And he never ascribed to himself lordship. He ascribed to himself prophecy. And you agree with that?
Yeah.
Fantastic. So after Jesus came and all of these prophets came, and they came with their miracles, and these miracles were used as tests for the people to either follow him or to deny him. Even in the Quran, it speaks about Jesus. I want to read to you something about in the Quran about Jesus, if you're okay with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your patience.
See you. So
oh, so you're very.
I just had to text. He's still.
Oh yeah, she's all right. Look, she's smiling. She's all right. So I just want to read the first couple of verses from Surah Al-Kahf. If you just bear with me. So it's the Surah of the Cave. So the people of the cave. If you just bear with me. And bless you for your patience. Thank you very much. Yeah. I know.
For her anyway.
Yeah, it's all right. By the time we finish, she'll be done, hopefully, yeah? So in Surah Al-Kahf, and this is from the first verse, I'm going to read down just to the fifth.
Yeah.
Is that okay with you?
Yeah, it's totally
so
fine.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, all the praises and thanks be to Allah who has sent down to his slave, Muhammad, the prophet that came after Jesus, the book, the Quran, and has not placed therein any crookedness. He has made it straight to give warning to the disbelievers of a severe punishment from him and to give glad tidings to the believers, in brackets, the ones who believe in the oneness of Allah, Islamic monotheism, who work righteous deeds. So you said obviously, you know, about that we have to come here and we have a certain law that we need to follow. They work righteous deeds that they shall have a fair reward, meaning paradise. They shall abide therein forever. And to warn those who say Allah has begotten a son. So meaning like when they say Jesus begotten son. No knowledge have they of such a thing, nor had their fathers. Mighty is the word that comes out of their mouths. They utter nothing but a lie. You know, and then when you go back to biblical scriptures, I mean, we're here on a weekly basis and we don't do it in a malicious way, but we speak to a lot of Christians, for example, and about how that their religion has been altered and how it's been changed. And we invite people to come back to the true monotheism that existed before when Jesus was going and preaching that there's only one God. Jesus in the Bible, he says, I go back to my father and your father, to my God and your God. Jesus also said, my father is greater than I. Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed to God. Jesus also says in the Bible, but you know, a lot of Christians try and take it out of context, that it says that Jesus was hurt. He was praying to God to be saved from sacrifice, from the crucifix, sorry, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Nowhere in the Bible does Jesus ever refer to himself as God. And there's so many versions of the Bible.
Yeah, I haven't read the Bible.
Right?
So
okay. I mean, the Bible is so many times longer than the Quran itself. There's so many opportunity in the Bible where Jesus could have referred to himself as God, but he never did it. Yet, he always refers to the Father in heaven as God. Now, the Quran is a book that came 1400 years earlier through our Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. What do you know about our Prophet Muhammad, if anything?
Not much. No.
May I tell you a little about him?
Yeah, just tell.
Fantastic. Because I know you're burning time. Yeah?
Burning time.
All right,
anyway.
Cool. So Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. He was a man that came from a noble family in the Arabian Peninsula, of Mecca, in the Valley of Mecca. Mecca itself is literally central to the earth. It's like right bang in the center of the earth. And interestingly enough, the Kaaba, you know, the house that the Muslims pray towards? It's interestingly enough, it is literally foot for foot, meter for meter, centimeter for centimeter. It is bang in the middle of the earth, which is an amazing phenomena in itself. I don't know how they would, unless this was by divine knowledge, how they could bring such a knowledge. But geographically and statistically speaking, it is. Now, Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a man that could neither read nor write. He was a man who was sent from a young age to the desert, and he was looked after by a Bedouin lady in a Bedouin family. Her name was Halima, and she looked after him for a few years. And then he went back to the city. He came from a noble family, a family that had, I wouldn't say royalty, but a family who were very well respected. However, these people that were in his family and the people around him in the village, they all used to worship statue idols. You know, so they would take the trees or the statue idols. They used to have many gods and they will pray to these gods. They'll have a god of war, god of peace, a god of this, a god of that. Just like the Greek kind of, you know, examples. And Muhammad, peace be upon him, to stay away from this. And he never used to worship gods himself. He went to a mountain and there's a cave inside there. It's called Hira. And he used to ponder upon this. People in his village down below, even though he stayed away from the idol worship, they knew him as two things, the truthful and the trustworthy. As-sadiq wal-amin in Arabic, truthful and the trustworthy. This is what they knew Muhammad, peace be upon him, as our prophet, yeah? He was also a shepherd, just like the prophets before him. I know Jesus was a carpenter, but just like many other prophets before, he was a shepherd. And this is interesting why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we believe that has always given this job to the people that he's chosen to be prophets, shepherds. A shepherd, someone who looks after their sheep. Sheep are animals by nature that conform, you know, and a shepherd is someone who has to look over them. He has to watch over his sheep, you know. So I mean, from young age, Muhammad, peace be upon him, obviously, he acquired these certain skills, this skill set. And later on, did he not know that he was going to be chosen? So basically what happened was, Pamela, and thank you again for being patient, yeah? He was in this cave and he was wondering and pondering about life, you know. Where the famous proverb came from, English proverb, a man can see very well from a mountain. You know, there's a proverb in English, a man can see a lot from a mountain, for example. And at one time when he was sitting there and reflecting, it was said that an angel came to him, and it was Angel Gabriel. And this is what we have from our scripture, yeah? And Angel Gabriel said to him, Iqra, read. And he said, I can't read. And he said that every time he turned, on every corner of his eye, he could see Angel Gabriel standing there. And he said, I can't read. And Angel Gabriel said again, Iqra, read. And he said, I cannot read. I am not of the learned. And this is, by the way, it says this in the Bible as well, about an up-and-coming prophet that says, I am not of the learned. And then Angel Gabriel said, Iqra, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaq al-insana min alaq. Read in the name of your Lord who created you from a single clot of blood. Read, who taught man what he did not know. Read. And this was the first revelation that came from God to Angel Gabriel to Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was married to a woman 50 years his senior, Khadija at the time. She was a famous businesswoman, very noble as well in her trade and very noble in personality and character. And he ran home to her and he was shivering under the blankets. And you know, he told her about this story and she then became the first believer of Islam. He wasn't sure still what was going on, but after that, he started receiving direct revelation from God. Anyway, thank you for that. That's just a little bit about our prophet, Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. It was 23 years after that first revelation that he lived and he preached that there's no deity worthy of worship but God, like what you said when we first started our discussion. Now, as Muslims, we believe in six pillars of faith that actually hold our religion together, our belief. So I wanted to ask you, interestingly enough, which one of them would you say that you can believe in and which ones you think are far-fetched, you can't believe in, yeah? So the first is belief in one God.
Yeah, I believe in that.
Belief in the angels of God.
I don't know so much about
Okay, no
angels.
Problem. Yeah. So to believe in the angels of God, it would be conditional upon a scripture that you would have to know that the scripture is divine and from God itself, if it said that there's angels from God. But after you've accepted a scripture, then you would probably believe, okay, cool. If you've accepted the scripture, you'd accept anything inside it, right?
Yeah. Agreeable? Idea of angels of cool, but it's English. Cool. I don't know.
No problem. So then the third one is to believe in the prophets and messengers of God. So for like Solomon, David, Moses, Noah, Aaron, Abraham, Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon them all.
I believe in the prophets.
Fantastic. And then to believe in the books, in the scriptures that they came with. So we believe that Muhammad, peace be upon him, he came with the Quran. Before him, it was Jesus. He came with the Old Testament, the Injil. Before him was Moses, Ten Commandments. Before him, you got David, Psalms of David. You know, all of these prophets, they came with messengers, so to speak. They came with all of these messengers.
Yeah, I believe in, yeah.
Fantastic, bless you. Then the fifth one is to believe in a day of judgment, including a heaven and a hellfire.
Yeah, I believe in, yeah, judgment, of course. Fantastic. Because I believe in one God. And
fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the sixth one we take is predestiny, to believe that divine decree, that everything is already written, God is the all-knowing.
No, I don't believe in fate or destiny. I believe you create your own. And of course, God has a plan, but I don't know. I believe that people create their own destiny and the choices we make gets us to where we are, not a divine God choosing for us.
Do you believe that God knows? Do you believe that God knew that I'm going to go like this?
No, I don't believe that. That's just human. That's nothing to do with God.
Okay, so do you believe that so God is not all-knowing?
No, not about all everyday stuff. He's all-knowing when it comes to the end, but I don't believe he just like sit like puppets and control every human being on earth to do something destined.
So it's an interesting theory that you've got now. I mean, the theory that you've got is definitely doesn't stem from original Christian belief, just from what you've said. and it's definitely not Islamic itself, because as Muslims we believe that God is the all-knowing.
Why are you even here?
So we believe that God is the all-knowing, and that there's nothing that God doesn't know, and there's nothing that we have as an ability over God. So for example, say me and you were in a room together and I handed you a silver coin, and there was no one there, and there's no cameras there, there's not none of these going on, yeah, and we say, oh look, we have a knowledge now between us that God doesn't know.
No, I don't believe in that. Of course I know that God sees everything. It's not about that. I just don't believe he goes down and makes us do anything.
Right.
That, yeah, I believe he sees it, but don't act upon it.
Okay. Now, what we believe as Muslims, actually, then, in now that you've clarified it, is not different. It's not actually different to what we believe as Muslims. What we believe is that God has not controlled us to the fact that he hasn't given us free will and choice. We believe that God has created us. He is the all-knowing, that he's created every knowledge in this world, and he alone knows this knowledge. Yeah, and whatever knowledge he's allowed for the angels to know, and whatever knowledge he's allowed for the prophets to know, and whatever knowledge he's allowed for each of us individually to know. Yeah, but he does know everything and every choice that we are going to make during our lives, because he is the one who has written it all, and he is the all able, he's the all knowing, the all seeing, the all hearing. This is Allah. This is who we believe. Our Lord and Master, he knows everything, but he allows free choice.
Yeah, that's my point.
So you can agree with that. Alhamdulillah. So we are on the same page regarding that. We believe, and this is why, in regards to this free choice, this is why we believe that there's a paradise and a hellfire. You got your reward, you know, you got your biscuit and your sweet, or you got your slap on the wrist, so to speak.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't believe in a hell. I believe in a bad place for people who treat other people bad.
Cool.
But also there should be a place for changing who you are. And
Penilla, what I would like to ask is, okay, so what is it that you came from a Christian background, yes?
Yeah.
What was it that made you lean away from Christian faith?
I don't know. I'm coming from a Christian background because all Danish people say they come from a Christian.
Yeah.
Not everyone practices it. My parents didn't practice it.
Okay.
I'm not sure my parents even believe in Jesus either.
Right.
They believe in God and religion as a label, not as something to.
But importantly enough, you believe that God is to be worshipped alone and there's nothing like him.
Yeah, I believe in that.
Fantastic. Yeah. Now, we are the only religion in the world up until now that we can honestly, truly say through our own scripture, the Quran, and through our own application of practice of the scripture, that we worship God alone and we ascribe no partners with him in terms of his names and attributes. Any thoughts on that?
No, not really. Okay. It's again, it's a label, it's a religion.
Okay, sure. Now, our Prophet, peace be upon him, we go by his stories as well. So Allah has left with us the Quran, which is a compilation of 140 chapters. Very clear, very poetic, very elegant, and no one has ever been able to create a text that is just like it in terms of its etiquette, so to speak, and language, level of language, and it originally came in classical Arabic. Now you can find it translated in many different languages. Now it's a book that speaks about many truths, and you know, for example, the reason why certain prophets were believed in before was because of the miracles that they came with. Some prophets, even the people around the prophets, were challenged. So for example, we have a prophet called Salih. I don't know what his name is in the Bible. Does anyone know what Prophet Salih is in the Bible? Is he not in the Bible at all? I beg your pardon. So it was from the people of Thamud. And Thamud is a place that they used to make a lot of big houses and stuff in the mountains and on mountains. Yeah. Now Prophet Salih was a prophet. He came to say, there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah. And this is what God has told me to tell you. This is what God tells us, sorry. Now, the people challenged Prophet Salih. And they said, right, we will follow your God if you can do one thing. Out of this rock, and there was a rock there, out of this rock, can you make a camel that is, I believe, 10 months pregnant, massive in structure? And Prophet Salih said, he prayed to God and God did it for them. Out of this rock came a pregnant camel, and the camel gave birth and it had a baby camel. The people were not satisfied. They killed the camel. So they killed the camel just out of their arrogance to God, and they continued their idol worship and whatever it was. Yeah, God caused just a sound, and they had warnings and warnings and warnings, and they were even plotting to kill our Prophet Salih, peace be upon him. God created a sound wave through lightning and thunder or whatever it may be, a sound wave that killed these people, just a sound wave. But I mean, that's just to show that through time, there's always going to be prophets who, there's always going to be people around prophets who come with arrogance. Even the people around Jesus.
Yeah, there's people around Jesus, there's people around Moses with arrogance too, the Pharaoh, yeah.
Around Noah, around Moses, yeah. Around Jesus.
Yeah, all of them.
Around Prophet Muhammad as well, peace be upon him. There were people who denied his message. From a man who was known even by the disbelieving folk to call him the truthful and the trustworthy, they then went on, when he started going out and saying, listen guys, stop worshipping what you're worshipping. Just worship Allah alone, because he's the one true Lord. And I come with you with the same message that that Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, the Prophet before me came with. And Prophet Moses, and Prophet Abraham, and Prophet David, and all of these prophets. And that message is, that I'm preaching to you guys, is that there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah alone. And then, he's made a conclusion in this, yeah? And that Muhammad, I myself, Muhammad, peace be upon him, am the prophet and messenger of God, and I come with the Quran. So all of the prophets before, they never went to testify that they were the final prophet. But Prophet Muhammad did. And the reason why, he came with a book now that was complete. It was free from any crookedness, and there was a promise in the Quran that there will not be any crookedness to be found in the text of the Quran. And it's the same book that we had then until now, and it's the only book that has never been changed. And this is, you know, all of these prophets, they came down with the miracles. So the miracle of Muhammad wasn't that he put a stake in water and the water went like that, like Moses. It wasn't that the fact that he lived like Yunus or Jonah in the whale of a belly. It wasn't the fact like he had powers like Jesus Christ. It wasn't. He had the Quran. And the Quran is a book that speaks about so many miracles. It speaks about the way that the moon is a reflected light of the sun. It speaks about the stages of embryology. It speaks, and it has so many numerical values and miracles and scientific values and miracles inside the text of the Quran. Putting aside all of the people that try and debunk the Quran, we come here on a weekly basis. My knowledge may not be right up there, but what I do speak is through certainty, and no one can ever debunk it. Why? Because I'm not here to be judged as a person. I'm here for people to speak to me about my religion, and I come to speak about Islam, and that's it. Just like a lot of our Muslim brothers here. So if I was to show you Pernilla, a book that I'm speaking of, that speaks about certain predictions, that it was only until, for example, last century or early this century that scientists were able to hold certain truthful accounts as such because of technological advancements. A book that is so technologically ahead, so scientifically ahead, so numerically ahead than any of the other books or any of the other historians and their works and what they come with and their theses and everything, would it make you ponder as to whether this book was a word from God and was a word from a prophet that said there's no deity worthy of worship?
I don't know. I have absolutely no idea.
Okay. So as with the Bible, as you said, have you seen yourself in the Bible that obviously, if you believe that there's only one deity worthy of worship, that's God, and that Jesus was a prophet of God, you yourself have stemmed away from the original, from Christian belief, yeah?
Yeah, a branch of the Christian belief.
Absolutely.
It's wide, but yeah. For one branch.
Do you believe that Prophet Jesus, he was a prophet?
I believe in Jesus. I don't know if he was a prophet or son of God. I don't know. Right. That's the point. I mean, there's a God, and then. Yeah. All the other is just like...
Right. I mean, Jesus always refers, interestingly enough, when he refers to God, he says, my father, but he also refers to the Father as God himself, but he never refers to himself as the Son of God.
No, he doesn't.
So, I mean, there's obviously a very big differentiation between that and a distinction, and people need to understand this. So when you refer to someone as a father, there's a phrase in Arabic, and this phrase is Rabb al-Bayt. Rabb means Lord. Bayt is house. So when you say Rabb al-Bayt, taking it to an English translation, it basically translates to mean Lord of the house. And this is something that we use in our language. You could use it in Danish as well, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Yeah, cool. So when we say Lord of the house, it doesn't mean anything more than boss of the manor, boss of the house, so to speak, yeah? So when God is when Jesus is referring to the Lord, Ya Rab, Lord, he's referring to the boss. And when people refer to Jesus as Rab, yeah, they can refer to him as Rab, Lord. But when they say Lord, are they talking about the creator? No. They're talking about creation. Jesus was creation, wasn't he?
Yeah.
We believe that Jesus will have us.
He's not creation.
All right, sad. Please, if you don't mind. I don't mind speaking to you afterwards. Yeah, thank you. We believe that Jesus, just like all of the prophets before, they came with a universal message. There's no deity worthy of worship but Allah. Do you, so from what I've told you about Muhammad, peace be upon him, I mean, what could we say firstly and foremost that all of the prophets they come with, what do they all stand, what do they have in similarity, would you say?
I don't know.
From what you know?
I don't know what they have in similarities. I don't know. I'm not a good with words.
Can I share some ideas on it?
Yeah.
Cool, thank you. So I believe that all of the prophets, they were all of good character, they were all good natured, you know, they were all truthful and trustworthy, yeah? And they all came with one universal message, that there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah. Reject all the false gods that all of you are worshipping and just follow the one true Lord, Allah. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, follow one God, yeah.
Yeah, fantastic. So one prophet after Jesus that we believe in as well, is Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. Now, as Muslims, as human beings, if we use the same thesis of understanding and the same way, the same filtering system to calculate and understand why all of these men were prophets before, like as you would do, Abraham, Moses, David, Jesus, we would also give the same calculation to Muhammad, peace be upon him, and the same value to him. Why? Because he's also a prophet that came with, there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah. And he also came with the same scriptures, the author of the same scripture. Basically, sorry, the scriptures that came from the same author.
Okay.
All of these scriptures came with about La ilaha illallah. There's no deity worthy of worship but Allah. Reject all of your false gods. He came with a story as well. People around him, what they were saying as well. They were all worshipping their statue idols. You know, they had a lot of economic destruction, a lot of social destruction, a lot of spiritual destruction. And Muhammad, peace be upon him, came to eradicate all of that. And he did a really good job of it. Now we're 1400 years down the line. Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world. The name Muhammad is the most common name in UK. My name is Muhammad. Is the most common name in the world. And Islam is growing strong, and it's growing stronger despite all of the ISIS talk, despite all of the terrorism talk. And interestingly enough, we mentioned, obviously, because you're from a country that, you know, a few stupid individuals, they took it upon themselves to blaspheme against our beloved Prophet Muhammad, yeah?
But yeah, in Denmark, you don't see it as blasphemy. It's not to provoke. It's just the Danish way of
expression.
It's right. Not like meant to, like, oh, now we want to,
right.
Yeah.
I mean, I believe that what, I mean, it's another matter, but what I believe and what many Muslims believe is that they should have at least took it in consideration about the faith themselves and what the people of those faith, how they would take it, because...
But that's not the Danish way, and it's not super woke. It's just like we believe in every person's right to speak out for themselves, and we don't do it to, like, think about, oh, this might provoke some religions.
Yeah.
It's not the point. It's just to... It's not the point, and Danish people didn't understand the reaction because it's just a drawing. Because,
well, I mean, I'm not here to slag them off anyway.
No, of course not. But it's just the reaction was just Danish people, what's going on, because they didn't understand why people were reacting so strong,
yeah,
about the drawings, because, yeah, we don't see it that way.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, as I said, we're not here to slag anyone else off,
and
you know.
Because if anyone like made drawing of our God or Jesus, Danish people wouldn't react that way because we couldn't see it as a provocative.
You know, for us, interestingly enough, Jesus's name is mentioned in the Quran a lot more than Muhammad, peace be upon him. He's someone who we love. We have a lot of love for Jesus, just like we did for all of the prophets before. But what I wanted to hear today, propose to you, Pernilla. So I've spoken to you a bit about Muhammad, peace be upon him. We've spoken about the six pillars of faith. And these are pillars that you understand and you believe. And we went over to further clarify upon the pillar of divine decree. But then after some clarity, we understand we're on the same page about divine decree and that Allah allows us to have free choice, yeah? Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
Okay. So then there was only one pillar, which is the second pillar that you are not too sure about. And that's the pillar of belief in the angels. So you've heard of Angel Gabriel?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you believe in the Angel Gabriel?
I still don't know if I believe in
it. Do you have any reason to disbelieve in Angel Gabriel?
No, I don't.
Cool.
It's just, yeah, scientific facts sometimes.
So what I propose to you is this as a question, okay? A book that came 1400 years ago that has not been altered, it's not been changed. It's so beautiful in terms of its text. And I mean, you can only take me for word value now. You'd have to actually go and see for yourself, yeah? It's a book that came with a prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him. And this was his miracle. This was the miracle that Allah, or God, gave to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And God gave miracles to the prophets before him. Yeah? Now, Muhammad came to say that there's no deity worthy of worship but Allah alone, and that he is the prophet and messenger of God. Now, If you were to look at this book and see all of the truth and what I'm telling you that is actually real within that book, could you accept, just like the Bible before it, and just like the Psalms of David and the Ten Commandments, could you accept that this is a book from a divine author?
I don't know still, because religion is like, to me, still all this flickering stuff. I don't believe in books or texts. I just believe in what you feel inside.
Sure.
And yeah.
Sure.
So,
you know, your belief is something that I empathize with, and I'll tell you why. I mean, although I was born and raised as a Muslim, we, as Muslims, alhamdulillah, we believe that we were born with the truth. Now, whether we apply it into our life or not, doesn't change the fact that the truth is and always stands as the truth. Whether we are good ambassadors or bad ambassadors of our faith, doesn't change the fact that our faith is perfect and Allah is perfect. Few of Allah's names, the all-able, the all-seeing, the almighty, the all-knowing, the all-wise, the all-powerful, the most gracious, the most merciful, the source of peace and safety, the Holy One. These are just 10 of the names of Allah, our Lord, the Master and Creator, yeah? Now, what I would just like to ask you and bless you for your patience today is, would you be able to go away and take a look at this book, which is the Quran?
Yeah,
I would love to leave you some of my details, and please do, any time of the day, send me an email. You can reach me on Facebook Messenger as well, and I'll give you that information as well. It will be at your disposal. Any questions you have, please get through to me about it. Our duty as Muslims is not to convince people. Our duty as Muslims is to convey the message in a way of good manners, a way of good conduct and character. And I hope, and this is part of our calling to Islam, calling to truth as well. You know, if I have made you feel uncomfortable in any certain way, alhamdulillah.
No.
If I did, well, then forgive me in advance, yeah? But
no, I like the information, the talk about it. I don't like being like preached something,
course.
But yeah,
regarding
it's
that,
just a debate.
Yeah, regarding that as well, our Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, said, there's no compulsion in religion. There's no compulsion in religion. My duty to you is to pass on the message. It's between you and Allah if you are guided or misguided.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Is there any final words you'd like to say to our viewers out there?
No.
Right, can I say some words?
Yeah.
And they are not patronizing. They're not patronizing,
no.
I promise you. Because as a believer, obviously, I want you to be guided upon the truth as well. Guys, everyone who is watching this out there, inshallah, please all raise your hands and make dua for this wonderful young lady. May Allah bless her with truth. And I'm not saying this in a patronizing way. I do hope, inshallah, that this lady does become a Muslim and accepts. She already accepts that there's one God. She already accepts that there is nothing like God. She already accepts that God is the all-seeing, the all-hearing, the all-able, the self-sufficient. That God is Al-Qadir, the all-able, the all-powerful. She accepts this. So please, guys, ask for dua to open this lady's heart, that she does go and see the Quran for herself. The miracle of this book that it is itself. She seems like a smart, intelligent lady. And maybe, how long are you in London for?
Just a couple of days.
Maybe she can keep in contact with myself, and I know a lot of people are going to try and reach out to you now. I promise you, when this video goes up, people are going to want to reach out to you. And maybe you can get back to us with some questions, and maybe we take it from there. Yeah? Sounds good?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Panilla.
Yeah,
it's been a pleasure speaking
you.
To you. And everyone at home, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How do you say bye in Danish?
Farvel.
See you later.